Welcome, everyone. Good evening. My name is Sam Raskoff. I'm the faculty director of the Center on Law and Security here at the law school. And as you can tell, there is a lot of enthusiasm and with justification for tonight's program, which features an exceptional panel to discuss a set of issues of exceptional importance. The Center on Law and Security is devoted to exploring the relationship between law and national security strategy and policy in tandem. Our center exists at the law school in order to deepen our understanding of these issues in relation to one another. And tonight's event, which is styled a conversation about Israel from the inside out, is therefore deeply connected to our project. Because our whole claim at the center is that in order to understand national security policy or to understand strategy in any given jurisdiction or country, you really have to understand deeply what it means to be a citizen of that country. You have to understand the nature of law, the project of the Constitution, the inner political and economic dynamics of the country. And so, in a sense, tonight's event is a perfect way to cap off what was already a very busy and fruitful semester. Zach Goldman, who's the executive director of the center, and I, and the center more generally, have done all sorts of programming in the area of national security oversight with regard to the NSA matter, with regard to ongoing questions of intelligence oversight more generally. There's a program at the center devoted to exploring public and private relationships in cybersecurity, and next March we will be hosting a major conference on deterrence in the contemporary national security world, which will be based in Abu Dhabi. I add only one more thing, which is I've had the high honor this semester, as I did last fall, to teach with one of our panelists this evening, the Weinstein Distinguished Fellow at the Center on Law and Security and the former president of Israel's Supreme Court, Dorit Beinisch, and we've taught a class devoted to exploring the way that courts around the world adjudicate national security. All of this by way of saying, we're very grateful for your attendance this evening. We look forward to having your participation both tonight, but also in future events at the center. Without further ado, I'm gonna turn the microphone over to Leon Wieseltier, our distinguished moderator tonight, who will in turn introduce the panel and get our conversation going. So thank you.
Good evening. I'm Leon Wieseltier, your distinguished moderator for tonight. When I was a boy growing up not far from here in Brooklyn, a group called Anthony and the Imperials produced a record, and it was called From the Outside Looking In. And tonight I'm in the opposite position. I am not an Israeli, even though I am, B'tocha mi anochi yoshev, but some distinctions have to be made. So when we speak about Israel tonight, essentially, I told my friends the other night when we first chatted, basically you have a panel tonight of three birds and one ornithologist. I'm the ornithologist. And so what we're gonna try to do is cover a lot of ground tonight. We have three people here who can speak with extraordinary authority about not just various aspects of Israel, but about particular aspects, but generally too. And then we'll see in questions and answers how specific we want to get. We're going to begin with each of the panelists discussing some larger themes, and then we'll get into it. And I will reserve the right to make a profound point or two occasionally, but basically I'm going to try to stay out of it. To my left, probably politically too, actually, is Dorit Beinisch, who has had a very distinguished career as a jurist, as a lawyer and a jurist in Israel. She was a state attorney in Israel, I believe the first woman to have held that position. She has served as a justice on the Supreme Court, and I think for 6 years, was president of the Israeli Supreme Court, also the first woman to hold that position. And we'll talk about various aspects of the themes that, as you know, her jurisprudence was distinguished by a concern for questions of human rights and democracy and the compatibility of national security questions with democratic values in Israel and more generally. Sitting next to her is my friend Stanley Fischer, who is a distinguished economist, was chief economist of the World Bank, and was governor of the Bank of Israel for, what, 2005 to 13, right? Something like that, yeah. And is renowned for somehow figuring out a way for the Israeli economy to grow while virtually every other Western economy was in deep, deep trouble. And I'm going to ask Stanley, one of the things I'm going to ask him is how on earth he did that. And sitting next to him is my beloved friend Moshe Halbertal, who all of you know. He teaches here at NYU and at and in Jerusalem and in Herzliya, and is, well, if you don't mind my saying, one of the most important Jewish scholars and thinkers in the world today. And I'm going to ask them each to speak generally about their realms, as it were, and we're going to break it down kind of coarsely. Stanley, I will ask Stanley to discourse a bit on the Israeli economy and some of the implications thereof. I will ask Dorit to do the same about the role of the judiciary in Israeli society, and then I will ask Moshe to talk a little bit about Israeli politics and political culture, and then we'll see where we go. So I think we agreed that I would start with Stanley. And I guess, Stan, the question that I want to ask you, it comes in two parts. The first one is there is the glittering story of Israeli economic growth during what was otherwise a desperate period for many Western economies, and the question of how that was done and so on. But then there's also the less glittering reality of economic inequality and enormous economic disparities within Israeli society, so that Israel is, you know, you hear a lot about this startup nation. On the one hand, it's the startup nation. On the other hand, it has an almost shocking poverty level, poverty rate. And I guess I want to ask you to talk a little bit about the economic miracle, as it were, and then to speak a little bit about the less miraculous aspects of what happened.
Well, thanks very much, Leon, and it's a great pleasure for me to be sitting on the same panel as two Israelis who I enormously respect and who are enormously respected, President Dorit Beinisch and Moshe Halbertal, and with somebody whose work I love reading, who is Leon Wieseltier, who has also saved me the trouble of saying what I'm going to talk about, because that was more or less what I prepared. I want to talk about the good Israeli economy, and then about the serious problems that there are in Israeli society that are economic and or economy related. So let me start with the Israeli economy, which, if you're a macroeconomist, which I am, is a significant success story. It's a country with a per capita income of about two-thirds of the United States level, somewhere around 32,000, 33,000, the U.S. about 47,000 per head. So the Israeli standard of living, the material standard of living, is about two-thirds of that of the average Israeli, is about two-thirds of that of the average American. The inflation rate is around 2%, which is where it's supposed to be. Was very high in the 1980s. That problem was solved. Israel, in terms of its inflation, looks like a model country today. It has a government budget which it is the job of central bank governors to complain about, and they gave us stuff to complain about. But compared with the rest of the Western world, the GDP, the deficit is now about 3% of GDP. It's very conservatively managed. And I would say that the government actually pays attention to those issues. And when we criticize it, when the Bank of Israel criticized them strongly about a year ago, they actually took steps to fix the budget problem, and they did. The balance of payments is in a small surplus. Israel exports more than it imports. And for those of you, the majority here whose hair is the same color as mine, if you remember, Israel was in massive deficit on the balance of payments forever, and nobody ever thought the day would come when Israel would be exporting more than it imports. Israel has discovered gas offshore. The deposits that have been discovered are pretty large. What their total effect will be is not known because there's still a lot more exploration to do. But on current estimates, the current estimates are that for the next 25 years, Israeli gas finds will supply about 40% of the power that is needed for electricity generation in Israel. So it will make a significant difference to this country. And the only negative on this one is that the old Israeli cabinet ministers joke, how come Moses wandered in the region for 40 years and managed to find the only country that doesn't have energy or oil, is no longer relevant. So that particular joke has gone away. There is, as Leon said, the high-tech sector. You've probably all, or most of you, read Startup Nation. Startup Nation tells a story in a slightly hyped way, but it is not hugely hyped. And it describes things that really do happen in the Israeli economy. And while high-tech exports were down a little bit last year, they seem to be coming back significantly at the moment, and that sector seems to be recovering its panache. Growth in Israel in recent years has been around 3 to 3.5%. That's not great, but it's sure better than what's been happening in most of the Western world. And Israel did not really have a serious recession during the Great Recession, as this period that started in 2008 is beginning to be known among economists. That's the good Israeli economy, and it's a remarkably good Israeli economy. It's not one that Israelis like to hear about very much. I more or less gave this speech when I was sworn in, or whatever, when the ceremony at which I was confirmed happened, and I gave more or less a speech, and everybody came up to me and said, "You really don't understand how bad the situation is." And you know, if you listen to the noise that the newspapers make, you will believe that this is a dream. If you look at the numbers, this is what the reality is. But Israelis don't like to think that they are successful in this area because it would imply that somebody in the government is doing something right, which is inherently implausible in the eyes of most of the Israelis. But it is true that the government has done a lot, but the private sector has done a whole lot more, and it's that very vibrant private sector, the high-tech sector, which accounts for much of the dynamism in the Israeli economy. So that's all to the good, and that's the economy which, at the aggregate level, Israel has. But there are many worrying internal developments within that economic framework. One of them is demographic, and that's not particularly caused by economic factors. But the composition of the population is changing in a way that is problematic from an economic viewpoint. The growth rate of the Haredi population in Israel is 4.2%. A population growing at 4.2% doubles every 17 years. The Arab population is growing at 2.8%. The rule is you divide 70 by the growth rate. So 70 divided by 2.8 is something like 25 years. It takes the Arab population about 25 years to double. It takes the rest of the population, which is growing at 1.7%, something like 35 to 40 years to double. So what you have is a changing population in a very serious way, in which two populations which do in which the rate of participation in the labor force is low are becoming an increasing part of percentage of the population. To dramatize things, if the current trends continued, by 45 years from now, the majority of the population would be Haredi, about 26%, plus Arab, about 24%, and the rest would be secular Jewish. That population, which, when you look at the numbers of it, is a Western European population, participation rates, income levels, everything. That part lives like Western Europeans, the others do not. And I have given many speeches to Haredi populations, Haredi crowds, at which I quote always Herbert Stein, with whom I worked on the Israeli economy. He was President Nixon's chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors. Many of you knew him as a Wall Street Journal columnist. He had a great sense of humor. He was a very wise man, and he had a whole series of sayings. And the saying I always quote to the Haredi population is, if something cannot go on forever, it will stop. It cannot go on forever that the share of the population which works least keeps growing, and you can maintain economic peace. That won't happen. And so I used to say, either the society, it will stop one way or the other. Either the society will impose it on you, or you will impose it on yourselves. And we'll have to see what happens. It is beginning to happen. The ultra-Orthodox men are beginning to work, beginning to get educated. It's in small numbers now. When I say educated, I don't mean in the yeshiva. I mean they're learning secular subjects, particularly math, particularly English, and some sciences. And that has to happen. And it may be beginning, but it really has to happen at a much more rapid rate. In the case of the Arabs, what I've been impressed by is that they go out and set up their own businesses. For a long time, they used to go to government and complain. Well, that's part of any effective strategy of making change. But doing it yourself is better, and they've been doing it. And they're much more into the business sector, and I think there'll be changes there. Together with that, Israel, which is famous for its high educational standards, is suffering declining educational standards. In what sense? Not in the sense that we run around and say, gosh, school was much harder when I was a kid. That's not the basis. There are objective tests by the OECD called PISA tests, which look at the educational attainment of school's children. Israel is now among 64 countries in something like the 40th place. And by the way, there are only 35 members in the OECD. The other countries do the test, even though they don't belong. So school attainment is falling. University attainment is falling. Israeli universities were among the best in the top 50 40 years ago. They're now way below that. They're in the 100th places and worse. That is not necessarily because the educational standards in the universities are declining, though I think that's happening. But it's because the rest of the world is really investing in this area, and Israel has not been investing in this area with anything like that rate, at anything like that rate. So demographics, educational decline, growing inequality in the society, although one has to be careful about saying that. It's growing inequality over the long term. It's actually been declining somewhat for the last 7 or 8 years, and a very high poverty rate. And here I have to explain to Americans that Israel and most of the world measure poverty differently than in the States. In the States, you're poor if you can't afford a given standard of living, which is defined by the government. In Israel, you're poor if you're below half the median income, the income in the middle. So in Israel, if everybody's income doubles, the poverty rate doesn't go down. In the States, if everybody's income doubles, the poverty rate really goes down. So there's a big difference there. And in fact, the poverty rate in Israel is a measure of inequality. And that has been increasing. All these problems are interrelated. And they relate to the educational system and how it's structured. I had the privilege of taking part in Israel's process of applying to join the OECD, the Organization of Advanced Economic Countries. There were political reasons. Israel should have been allowed in long ago. And there were political reasons it wasn't, but in 2008, Israel was accepted. At the hearings, there was, on Israel's entry, the Minister of Education then, who was Gideon Saar, gave a speech describing the Israeli schooling system. There are four streams, there are ultra-Orthodox, there are medium-Orthodox, et cetera, and then there are secular and Arab. And some guy put up his hand and he said, if you have four streams of education which are not the same, how can you build a nation? And I said to myself, this guy really doesn't understand the Middle East. But the more I thought about it, the more I thought he had a point. And the education system is creating differences among people, the schooling system. And without changes in the attainment of education, this worsening of the internal economic situation is likely to continue, and it's a very, very serious thing. Now let me tell you the last thing, and that's about peace. The miracle of Israel, in many ways, is its apparent normalcy. I was standing outside saying goodbye to a visiting American one night at our house somewhere around midnight near Herzliya. And he said, it is astonishing to me that we're standing here feeling completely comfortable 15 miles away from the border. And that is the achievement of Israel's defense forces. Israel now spends much less on defense than it ever did before as a share of its GDP. And after the Yom Kippur War, Israel spent a third of its total output on defense. And if you want to know why it got into such a mess in the 1980s, it's because the defense burden was overwhelming. And they couldn't deal with it without inflation, which created lots of other things. That spending has been going down, down, down. It's now about 8% of GDP. But there are always more threats, and there are always reasons to spend more on defense. And Israel is in a moment when it wants to spend more on defense, and where it looks like that's necessary. And the approach of we have to be strong, because if we're not strong, we will be defeated, is absolutely correct. But it is not the only part of a winning strategy. And the other part is the need to look for peace. And that part is not happening to the extent that it should. The country seems to me to be divided between those who want to settle the West Bank and those who want to make peace. And that is a huge challenge for the future of this country, whose attainments are really extraordinary. To think of what has been achieved since 1948 is to understand that there has been a miracle in Israel. It has to continue. And Israelis can do it if they look the facts in the face. Thank you.
Thank you, Stan. I'm now going to ask Dorit Beinisch to talk a little bit about the role of the judiciary in Israel. In your work, Well, let me begin by saying that there, those of us, regardless of one's feelings about the current prime minister, many of us have noticed that in recent decades, Israeli society has come to rely more and more upon the judiciary for the establishment of certain basic values, let's say, more and more upon the courts, and less and less upon the political system. And I guess what your career, you have distinguished yourself by championing the value of the judicial review of governmental power, in terms of government corruption and also behavior, military abuse, et cetera, et cetera. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about your view of, I guess, the proper place of a judiciary in a democratic society and the actual place of the Israeli judiciary in Israeli society. I should precede what Dorit's about to say by saying that, given her career and her service and so on, there are things that she will not be able to say, and I'm going to try my very best to get you to say them. So, just.
Well, we'll see. I'll try. Well, Stan, you said that the miracle of Israel, and now we are in the days of Hanukkah, and I can tell you, the whole thing, it looks like a miracle, but what happened cannot be a miracle. It's a lot of work and building a new society, really a very complicated society. And here, in the center where we sit and discuss security issues, we are always used, and Israel is used, to feel that our worries during the years of the existence of the state are from outside. And this is, I think, a very special evening where we try to talk about Israel from inside. And I believe, and I think this is what you expressed too, Stan, that we have dangers from inside, not less than from outside. And the role of the court is, of course, on this, to be a guard for those preventing those dangers that our society has to face. We are really a very complex society with a lot of achievements. Sometimes it's really like a miracle. I think it's a creative society. It's a society that built from zero, from the ground, a culture, science, really with all those problems of education, art, literature, and a wonderful judicial system. I want to believe so, because it's an independent judicial system, it's an apolitical judicial system, and this is what gives our courts the power to be so important and relevant in our society. Because we have so many problems because of the composition of our society, of our population that you mentioned, gaps in so many aspects between different groups of Israelis. As you said, and you mentioned only the problematic from the economic point of view, of course, which is very, very scary. I mean, it's those two societies who do not have the opportunity to be, I think, or do not contribute to our economy, which is the Haredic society, the Arabic society, but this is only part of it. This is a country with differences between those who were born second and third generation already in Israel, those who just immigrated to Israel from different cultures, Russians, Ethiopians, different views on everything. The consensus of the state is on a very narrow basis. The consensus is really, we have to exist. We exist as a Jewish democratic state, as it was stated already in our Declaration of Independence. This is a home for the Jewish people. This is a home for every Jew. But this is also a society that has to protect democracy, which means equality, and values of a democracy. because of so many differences and because we don't really have a consensus about what are the values, even not, we don't even have a consensus what is a Jewish state, because there are different thoughts what is Jewish. Of course, the Orthodox would think different, the secular think different. So, but this is a state which is a home for the Jewish people. This is a state that actually created and renovated the Hebrew language from the, and the, in the, we live according to our national symbols and what else? I don't think we come to a real consensus. This is, now what is the role of the court in that situation? First of all, like every court, I believe in a democratic society, its role is to protect human rights, to protect the constitution, and we also have a constitution in our way, we'll come to it maybe, but we have, and to the values, to protect the values of democracy, which is really the role of the court. Now, in such a pluralistic society, a divided society, maybe the court represents more than any other institution, an institution that is a branch of government, which is not political, as I said before, which could express the basic values of the state. And as I said, this is also not that simple, because what are the values that we all share? I mentioned some of them. I believe that all of us want to be like a democratic Jewish state, a democratic state, which means state that gives rights to all the people in the state, state that protects their rights, and who does it? The court. Now, what is so very special about our court, and I believe that, a court where the Supreme Court that reviews government activities is accessible to everyone, which is, I think, the greatest achievement of our court, because everyone can reach and directly the Supreme Court of Israel. And this is very important. This is also part of the trust of the people in the court. So you can understand that not all the politicians are very happy about what a court is. No one likes the institute that reviews their activities. But we do. And I think that this is one of the most important things that the court really did during its existence of 65 years with the state. Some of the issues that our court has to confront and to tackle with are not known to other courts. All those problems that come from gaps in society, from security problems, security to have maximum security, which is impossible, and to protect human rights and to balance between them is a very, very difficult task, very. And then I think some are not satisfied that we are considered an activist court. I don't really accept those labels, what is activist and not activist. Some would think that we are activists, some would think we are not activist enough. But and we are, of course, a court that has a tradition, a common law tradition. We have a lot of Israeli legislation, but precedents that are binding, not always easy to comply with because of the special situation, because we are reviewing matters that are not always accepted by everybody. But I think we've done what we can expect from a court in a very difficult situation. Justices of the Supreme Court, they have to decide on the rights of terrorists at a time when we had terror activities, when buses were exploding in the streets, in cafes, in where people live, and we are part of these people. Justices that have to decide, and now it became, it's again the topic you were talking about, more and more now, have to confront the problems that come from social and economic rights because of the gaps, because not we this became the most difficult problem now for the people, the population who expects the government to give more to protect more the social conditions and rights. Not everyone is happy for what was done. Here steps in the court, again, with I think, again, it is I won't say courageous, but it's new for, and not every court would deal with those issues too. So, and of course, what I think we'll come to it later, what does it mean that we do have a constitution where actually nothing is similar to the American constitution? Mm-hmm. It's a different situation. So, and maybe one of the secrets, which I hope we will keep, I'm not very sure about it, I hope it will go on, one of the secrets of the court being so independent is the system of appointing judges, which made it an apolitical court. And I hope this will always be so, because politicians do not like so much the power that they lose if they cannot appoint judges. And who knows more about it than the Americans? So that's, I hope we'll keep our very independent court. I think for the beginning, that's
okay,
it.
Good. Thank you, Dorit. Moshe, I'm going to ask you now about not so much about politics, but about Israeli political culture. And the question I want to ask is this. When one surveys Israel in all its realms, if one looks at the economy, despite or alongside the problems that Stan outlined, and one looks at culture, one looks at technology, one sees a society running on an enormous amount of energy and talent, really, really flourishing. When one looks at Israeli politics, however, one doesn't come away with the same brilliant picture. And sometimes it seems to me that the only realm of Israeli life that is dysfunctional right now is Israeli politics. And I'm wondering if you could, I mean, you may not feel that way, but I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the political cultural situation in Israel right now, and the sense that many people have that there is, and again, this has nothing to do with the current prime minister, though if I say that one more time, you'll know exactly what I think about him. But I mean, it's just a, but.
Take in consideration, we all know him.
That's, you know, that's for you to bear. I mean, it's just a, but is there a crisis of leadership in Israel? Is there a political crisis? Is it a crisis of principles or institutions? What is it about Israeli politics that sometimes seems inadequate to the enormous challenges that Israel faces right now?
Well, I would say the following. I think that some of what looks to be like a political crisis has underlying transformations. Very deep transformations in the society that are challenges that are really above the day-to-day maintenance of politics. I want to talk about three of them, right? And some of these are my worries about the future of the country and the future of its politics. And they're related to things that Stanley has said and Dorit had said. I want to talk about three issues that they implicate Israeli politics in a deep way. And really, these issues are developing from the 70s onwards in the country. The one thing is you have a transformation of the ultra-Orthodox world and growth. Now, when I was a kid, right, growing up in a family that had very deep roots in the ultra-Orthodox world, the ultra-Orthodox position in the 50s or the 60s vis-a-vis the country is they are Rabbi Shach used to say, Galut Israel b'yad Israel, the exile of Israel under Israel. Mm-hmm. We are a minority, you know, very small. There is a momentous secular nation state, and we have to protect our culture. And I remember, again, a childhood memory in one of the ultra-Orthodox neighborhoods in Jerusalem, an ultra-Orthodox man burned the Israeli flag in Independence Day. And one of the smartest rabbis of the ultra-Orthodox world, the Brisker, said to him, I see you have become a Zionist. Mm-hmm. he says, what do you mean? I'm burning the flag. He said, would you dare do it in Russia? He said, no. He said, here you feel at home. So there was that very powerful very powerful attitude towards the country that has that they are a minority, you know, resisting for a variety of deep reasons the modern nation, national Jewish movement, and they have to protect their culture. Now that it's dramatically changed. I mean, and we can talk a lot about what were the reasons of the changes. You know, the ultra-Orthodox Agudat Israel used to support the government from the outside, but never sat in the government because that was too much involvement with the nation state, right? In the last government that the Haredim were in, they actually sat in the government. They had a deputy minister of health, Yaakov Litzman. But he could be only a deputy minister. He cannot be a minister. But one interesting thing, talking about miracles of Hanukkah, there was no minister of health.
We wrote a judgment about two.
What you have here is an entry, I would say, an entry of the Haredi ultra-Orthodox world into the life of the state. A lot of it has to do with immense economic dependency that had to do with ultra-Orthodox were men not working, and Stanley talked about that, right? The ultra-Orthodox economy was the father-in-law economy, the mechutin economy, mm-hmm. right? There was a men worked and one was supported to be the, you know, the future scholar, but all of, you know, when all men work, there are no more father, when men go to study, there are no more father-in-laws. And there is what I would call the mechutanization of the state. Right? The state has become the father-in-law. So that actually created an immense integration of the Haredim into the life of the country. Now, there are some very positive aspects to it, but there are some other new dimensions because there is a new pressure brought to bear on the nature of the country, an impact on the country, because when they were a minority wanting just to protect their own lifestyle, they weren't interested in a Jewish state. They weren't interested in a state altogether. Now, there is a pressure, I would say a growing theocratic appetite. A growing theocratic appetite. By the way, the court was one of the last institutions that stand against it, mm-hmm. and stand against it apropos the political culture, because it wasn't willing to trade, to make the usual trade-offs that the politicians do. You want to form a government? Okay, we'll give you, you know, we'll compromise on the rights of women here. You want to do that? It wasn't, you know, it wasn't up for the market of politics as it practiced in Israel. So that's one issue. Right? That's one issue that Israel will have to deal with in the future. That's an immense impact on the country. Then you have the Arab citizens of Israel. Now, these are, by now, 21% of our citizens. They are citizens of Israel. Also, they have gone through a dramatic change, which we'll have to take into account seriously when we think about the future of the country. The traditional Arab politics in Israel was, we are a discriminated minority here, and it's true to a certain degree. They had political rights, I mean, to a certain degree, in a way, a tribute to Israeli democracy, that they had full political rights, but there was ongoing discrimination vis-a-vis land distribution, infrastructure, education, other things. And the goal of the leadership of the Arab-Israeli political elite was, let's try to close this discrimination within a Jewish nation state. Now this minority has shifted from the rhetoric of being a discriminated minority in a nation state to being an occupied minority, a minority under occupation where the idea or their ideology is to say the only way to solve our grievance is to dismantle the nation state. So you have two forces, very interesting, today. One wants a Jewish state that is not democratic. This is the ultra-Orthodox. And the other wants a democratic state that is not Jewish. And they both growing. And now I think Israel's future depends on its capacity to include them, to bring them in a serious way. And the main thing vis-a-vis the Arab-Israeli minority, the Israeli citizens, the Arab citizens of Israel, is to embrace them in a serious way as full-fledged citizens of the country. And here again, the court had a big role, but the court cannot carry all that mission. It has to do with administrative decisions. It has to do with many other things. And vis-a-vis the ultra-Orthodox world, it has to set limits. And it has to set limits to the appetite, I would say the dangerous appetite, to use the coercive machinery of the state to adjudicate Jewish identity. I mean, this is very terrible for any democratic understanding of pluralism. You don't want the Knesset to decide how Shabbat looks like. I live in Jerusalem. Shabbat looks like in Jerusalem in a certain way. Rumors have reached Jerusalem that in Tel Aviv it looks different. Now, you don't want the state to engage in, you don't want the coercive machinery of the state to engage in that. By the way, this is bad for democracy, but this is even worse for the
religion. Yeah.
For religion. Mm-hmm. Right. And I tell, and I think there is actually a growing understanding among the ultra-Orthodox as well, that there will be an inverse relationship between the state and its citizens. The more the state will be Jewish, the less its citizens will be Jews. And this will be, and there is, but this is a big issue. We're going to have to, Israel's future depends on its capacity to embrace, integrate these two growing minorities into its life. And then there is the third issue. And the third issue is the ongoing control of the West Bank. Now, and I would say here I'm basically the only one who feels free in some ways to talk about politics here, right? So that's fine. This is just a point of view, naturally, right? My point of view. And Stanley said, well, things that cannot last forever will have an end. With the ongoing control of the West Bank, Israel might have very good reasons for continuing it. It will find itself in a position that it will be either South Africa or Lebanon. And this is not a good future. That means that it's an imperative, Israeli imperative, an internal Israeli imperative to reach a two-state solution. Because its future, internal future, I'm talking about the generation of my children, grandchildren, they're not going to survive as a minority in their own country. No group can survive in a minority in its own country. Now, I would like to say, people would say, and rightfully, that this is a complex problem, and Israelis have good reasons, and you hear them, to be worried about it. And there is one interesting thing you see in the country, which is fascinating, and that has to do with the political culture of the last 15 years. And then I would say the last comment about the political culture. In the last 15 years, there is a greater and greater understanding that the two-state solution has to happen. Even among the parties who always resisted it. But as this understanding deepened, you have a greater and greater distrust and mistrust of the other side, simultaneously. I would say, I'm not a fatalist. I hear many people who are very fatalist about this issue and say it's insolvable. My reading, again, it's my reading, is that in both sides, there are 60% who want a two-state solution, more or less, it's not going to be just in the full sense of the word. The 60% polls are showing it again and again. And 80% of those 60% don't believe that there are 60% in the other side.
Right. Right, right.
And this is a big issue to overcome.
Right.
So very deep issues. But, you know, this is not a matter, I'll tell you the following thing. This is not a mere matter of geopolitical strategic issue. It's not the Golan Heights. You give it back, you don't. This will have an impact on the very identity of the state. I'm talking about long run. And so these are the three, I would say the three concerns that I have vis-a-vis the political culture. Now just the last remark about Israeli democracy and political culture. No, Israeli democracy is very vibrant. There is huge civic participation. And some of it, and here's a tension that I always worry about our political culture, it takes the following form. Israeli politics is high-stakes politics, right? High stakes. Basically, the left and the right think of each other as a threat to the life of their own children. Right, we don't talk politics at my mother's home because basically we each of us see the other as a threat, as an existential threat, right? Especially in the Seder, you don't want to talk in Passover politics. That's, I once joked that our Seder, when we talk politics, becomes Pharaoh's revenge. Mm. Now, so
you should invite John Kerry to you.
So you have high stakes politics, which actually brings high level of participation. And everyone who has been to Israel knows this is an obsessive political culture. It's kind of the one of the last of the polis. And it's a very good thing for a democracy. Especially, by the way, it's not only high stakes. You know that every election might tilt the other way. There is no strong majority to either side, which brings political, it's a boiling temperature of politics. But the problem is the following, and it is, I think, a great paradox of every democracy. Democracy is, after all, a nonviolent procedure of adjudicating differences. And democracies manage to adjudicate their differences because politics is low stakes. And what allows for participation doesn't allow, or I would say, is an obstacle for that capacity to say, okay, let's agree on a nonviolent procedure to adjudicate our problems. There is always the verge that this intense high temperature politics would not survive the burden of nonviolent procedures. And that if you ask me about the miracle of Israeli democracy, the genuine miracle, you know, there are the security threats, etc. It's how you maintain nonviolent procedures with ongoing high-stakes politics that tilt every time with small majority to the other side. For me, that's a big issue. And I Stanley talked about normalcy. Sometimes I say to myself, there's so much beauty in participation. Stanley said to myself, we wish to reach a point where the temperature of the political debate will be lowered. So the insurance that we can engage in a nonviolent procedure will be safeguarded and stronger. But I would say, I think, if you ask me, my three larger concerns are these.
Thank you. We'll open it up to... I have to confess, a lot of this leaves me very melancholy. Some of the transformations that have been described here seem to me very deep and very structural, and at the level of, if you will, political philosophy, also very deep, so that one, I find myself wondering how exactly can a state that wants to maintain itself as a democratic and a Jewish state come to include large constituencies who want it to be democratic and not Jewish and Jewish and not democratic. I wonder if at some point you reach moments of, I guess, moments of real crisis and how they can be averted. I guess that's one of the reasons we're talking so much about miracles, not just because it's Hanukkah. But I want to have time for questions. And so I will ask, is there a microphone? Yes, there's a microphone there in the middle. I beseech you to put your questions in the interrogative form. Okay, we'll start right here. Microphone right behind you, yes. I think the question is, Moshe, I think the question is, aren't you wrong? Yes, 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 yes. Yes, yes.
Oh. I mean, look, I first of all, let me start. The answer is that I did give it some thought.
Really? You should don't brag.
I'm bragging.
Yes.
Let me say the way I see it. I think the following. I think that clearly there are risks involved, right? And you mentioned some of them, and a smart policy will say, how do we minimize those risks? Security arrangement, other things. But it's not like if you don't solve it, it's not like, then we just safer and that's fine. There is a price, a huge price to pay. And the price is really the future of the country as a viable place. You might have, by the way, a country with very good secure borders to protect itself, but not a country worth protecting. Now, and then you ask yourself, like the tragic or difficult questions of life, and whoever, every politician of the left, of the center, has said there is no risk involved, is not seeing the situation properly. But what caused a major shift, by the way, among not the left in Israel, but among the right in Israel, I include that Sharon and Olmert and others, right? Livni, now she's doing the peace process. She was once in the other side. What happened to them? What, they talked to some peaceniks and became naive about the world? No. They saw a certain reality, very hard reality, which is, what will be the future of this country? And they said, we're going to have to make a choice. And the choice is very difficult. You're right. I would say the choice is very difficult. At the end, a great statesman and a great politician or a great citizen will ask himself the following question. Which risk I hope to take? That's the question. It will be, not serious for me to say there are no risks, clearly.
But I would add to that, I think not in your case necessarily, because I don't know you, but it certainly is the case that many people who argue that there is no solution use the rhetoric of no solution to advance what in fact they regard as an acceptable solution. That is to say, to decide not to do certain things on the West Bank is to advocate a particular outcome, which will follow from not acting in certain ways.
Okay.
Yeah, but
I'm just you. I would say the following. You would ask me to present the way I perceive the issue, The way I perceive the issue is opting between two risks and making a serious judgment of where to go and which of the risks to minimize. And that's where we are. And it's a tough point. Clearly, by the way, apropos Leon's comment, one thing you don't want to do is create an irreversible conditions on the ground that would not allow for a future compromise. Yeah. It's called settlement. And the last thing you want to do, by the way, is make it the major piece of your foreign politics. That's not smart. Even if you think this way, it's not a smart politics.
I remember once I was arguing with a right-wing politician in Israel who was making the argument that there's no partner and no solution, and I found myself saying that just because the doctor tells me I don't have lung cancer doesn't mean I should smoke. I mean, it's there are very stupid things that one can do even in the absence of immediate partners. Question over there. You, yes. Yes, yes. You.
All right.
Yes.
Yeah, I've got a lot of voice. I probably can speak without the mic. I'm just curious about the difference in legislature, you know, between American and Israeli system. In Israel, it seems to me the legislators do not represent people. They do not have constituencies. And here, they do represent people. They do not represent ideas as they do in Israel. And I'm just wondering, when constituencies and their representatives rub against one another, the views of both tend to moderate. And it seems to me that there is a great virtue in legislator representing somebody rather than representing his party, which makes for very intransigent and very rigid views that we often read about, you know, in Israeli politicians. Not enough flexibility. Why is it that Israelis do not kind of, you know, do not divide themselves into districts and run against one another? And maybe 100% of Knesset would be Likud, or 100% of Knesset will be Meretz or whatever. But that's the result of that's democracy. But what you have is not a democracy, but some kind of intellectual
I wish.
Wait, Dorit, do you feel at liberty to address this?
Yes, well, I don't think that you can say that our legislature doesn't represent the people. They do. This is a different system. You know, what you suggest, I think Ben-Gurion at his time wanted to change the system, and he wanted that system.
And he also wanted to do the redistricting.
Yes, but the district, we know that it not always represents the right thing, and you have examples for that. I do believe we're a small country. I believe the legislature represents. Maybe there are better systems, maybe. But I don't think that the problem is that they do not. There are many reasons why we have so many parties. This is true. We don't have a bipartisan system, which we know now that doesn't always work so good. But anyway, I think, with all due respect, this is not a problem. They do represent, maybe they could have better representatives, but they were elected through a system of a party system. And I don't think we have any chance to change it. Although the idea that we really had parties that you knew for years, who is the party and who they represent. And today, with the change of society, parties changed and you don't really know. But this is not because they don't have constituents.
Anyway,
they are elected by their constituents in another system. That's
In 2013, it's kind of odd to ask Israelis why they don't act more like Americans politically. I mean, it's just. Stan, you wanted to say something.
Yeah, when I arrived in Israel, I was sure that a constituency system was the solution to everything. But the more I look at it, the more I think that if you had a constituency system, given that each area is typically identified with a particular group, you'd end up with the way the constituencies are drawn as being the determinant of what the outcome of an election is. Gerrymandering in the United States would look like child's play,
right,
relative to what is would be possible in Israel. And I'm less certain, in fact, that I think it's wrong to think that a constituency system would solve particular problems in the Israeli political setup.
Sir.
Well, you can ask the same question about every process of balancing the judges do. Mm-hmm. How do we balance? It's a question, but there is a technique. First of all, as to the Constitution, we do have basic laws. It's not a full Constitution. It's not enough. We would love to have, I mean the judges, would really believe that we should have a Constitution, a full Constitution. But I think our basic laws and the power that the court took to review legislation gave us, actually, the situation is very similar to a constitutional judicial review. Nothing, you cannot compare any constitution really to the role that the American Constitution has in the American culture. But I do think we developed a kind of constitution and constitutional values. How do we balance? Well, it's not easy. We use rules, certain rules. We use the rule of proportionality, which we didn't invent it. It's used in Europe, in international law, in most of the countries that we know. And the idea is that, very broadly speaking, that you take what are the rights that you should protect, and you balance, which means then you have to see what are the rights that were injured because of the security needs or other needs that the means that the government took, and you try to minimize injury to human rights without really losing the important aspect of security, and of course we need it. So this is a process that we know already. I believe that we have the tools for a right balance. Not everyone accepts that balance. Sometimes they think we went too much this way or the other. But at the end, it is professional. It is not just the feeling, the gut feeling of a certain justice this way or the other. So, in
Sir.
Short.
Well, when you read the Haaretz, very high quality paper considered on the left, of course. If you read it on a regular basis, you sometimes get a very dismaying picture of Israel, especially as colonists. Not just its future, but its current. You read about a lot of people that seem to be very unhappy with the country, where it is, not just where it will be. But, and one of the interesting things is that over the years, Haaretz has had a column where it interviews people. It's the most interesting column there. And it says, how are you doing? Just gives a description of their daily life, and rich, poor, Ashkenazic, Sephardic, etc. And then at the end, they ask them to rate your life on a 1 to 10 basis. Almost every single time, they rate their life as 9 or 10. And this is right next to the columns of the terribly depressed columns about Israel. Does that suggest that the majority of the people are perhaps foolish, naive, or is there a certain wisdom in these people,
sure,
or some mishmash of both, perhaps, idea like that? But is there something that they're missing that the people who are more concerned and more worried are seeing that these people will see in a few years?
By the way, if I was asked, I would rate between 9 and 10 as an Israeli, right? I love the country. I love being there. I think the fabric of daily life is exceptional. It's too bad that Stanley now is here. It used to be even more exceptional when Stanley was there. So it is, you know, it's a great country. And I'm not fatalistic about its future because it has a lot of talent. It has vibrancy, it has cultural vibrancy that is immense in terms of music, poetry, art. By the way, in terms of also Jewish scholarship, in my little neighborhood in Jerusalem, there is so much Jewish scholarship. There is a great thing called Israel. You know, all those concerns are not about withdrawing from that precious thing. It's about questioning how we keep protecting it, nourishing it. And, you know, apropos Stanley's point about education, I mean, I teach in both countries, so I have an immediate experience in education. I meet students. I mean, an Israeli classroom is a very interesting class, to say the least. I would say, roughly speaking, it is a very sharp way to put it. Here, all the students read and most of them don't talk. There, all of them don't read and most of them talk.
Now, I want to know how many of your students are in the room. Would you please raise your hand?
No, I said most.
Yes, yeah.
I'm saying the following. There is a great quality. I think part of the interesting aspects of life in Israel is the actual gap between the fabric of the day-to-day engagement in life and the larger looming geopolitical internal questions. I think that there is a, Leon might be a little bit depressed, right?
You mean generally or about this? No, I also would score 9 to 10. Thank you very much. Yes.
I think that there is a, the country has a lot of power, a lot of strength, a lot of vitality, including the vitality to overcome serious issues. What we are trying to do here is just to outline that.
Also, there's no contradiction between worry and happiness. Mm-hmm. In fact, Jews have a genius for combining worry and happiness.
So which one would you ignore a little bit?
Well, I remember, our Moshe, our old friend Sidney, he had an old Jewish mother who took ill, and when you asked her how she was feeling, she'd say, "Not so good, thank God." Stan, you wanted to say something.
You actually spotted something which shows up in international studies. There are very big studies of international happiness, and the Israelis rank very high in those. Israel ranks high as a society where happiness is high. There are societies where people are very unhappy. Hungary is among the worst. The only thing that kind of, I don't know whether this would want to make you religious, but the happiest reportedly among the Israelis are the Haredim, who are 99% happy or something like that, in these studies.
There is a kind of paradox in Israel life. If you come in the most tensed times, really when there is tension and even security worries very serious, Israelis are on, as you said, all of you, on a daily basis, very happy with their life. And you don't feel it. And when people are visiting the country, they say, well, you know, when you come from outside, you think everyone is scared and worried what's going to happen. And people look really happy. But this is only one side of it. There are many aspects that people are worried. First of all, the economy, even when it flourishes, those who are poor, and those who suffer from feel that they are discriminated against, feel discriminated against. And the most worrying thing, as I think all of us said, is the potential of what could happen. And with this, we should be worried. But everyday life, it's a good climate, nice, happy, cultural life. People eat the sunshines, so.
Thank you.
Well, first of all, I want to thank our panelists. As an NYU law student, I feel very grateful for the privilege of so much genius here on one panel. I have a question mainly for Dr. Fischer about the intersection between the national and the individual. Since, after all, you represent both the national story of Israel's economic miracle and also an individual story of Aliyah, of moving to Israel. On the individual level, I would be curious very much to hear your thoughts about what it was like to integrate into Israeli society, to work in Hebrew. What about Israeli life and society spoke to you most, and what your advice would be for folks here considering a similar move? And on national level, I would be curious to hear how you would characterize the role and the impact of Olim on Israeli society, and whether you think Israel would be better off if more diaspora Jews would move to Israel.
So, Stanley, was your integration successful? Yes, yes.
Well, I, as I was listening to Dorit, I thought that the question that was going to be asked is, what are you all doing here? And you're asking it. Integrating socially, well, we had a lot of friends. We have a lot of friends in Israel, and we had them before we arrived. So integrating socially was not that difficult. Social life is, I think, let me say nicer. Is more pleasant in Israel than it is in New York, even in Washington, and even in California. People are warm, people are interested in you, and not only because I had a particular position, but that's the way life is. You're invited to other people's homes much more frequently and so forth. We had a Chinese visitor at the Bank of Israel for 3 months. He somehow hit it off with the entire staff. He went to more bar mitzvahs, more weddings, more funerals in those 3 months than he'd done in his entire life. And you just get integrated, and it's very nice. Political life is tough. And you know, they don't hold back in saying what they think, and you just have to realize that's the way the game is played. And you Americans could play that very, very well. So I think it's pleasant to live in Israel. It's rewarding to live in Israel. If you want to go on Aliyah, you better learn Hebrew at some point, because it's very hard to integrate in the society if you don't speak it. And it's important that you do that. And then you've got to be recognized. I mean, people who come and leave after 3 months strike me as, it's odd. I always say it takes me 3 years to get used to a new place, sometimes 2 years. But so you've got to expect some period of adjustment. And at some point, you'll suddenly realize this is where I fit in, I think. But good luck.
OK, I think one more. Sir, I apologize to everyone who wasn't called on tonight.
Thank you very much. Moshe said that Israel has to do something about the West Bank, because otherwise, eventually, we'll be facing a choice between South Africa and Lebanon. And my question is, isn't it going to make that choice eventually, regardless of what it does with the West Bank, just within the current borders of Israel, within the next 60, 70, 80 years, say? And can that necessity of keeping Israel a Jewish state be addressed as part of a two-state solution by, I think, Avigdor Lieberman, as another people have supported the idea of bringing Jewish parts of the West Bank within Israel and are leaving the more Arab parts of Israel as part of the Palestinian state. And is that a viable solution, and doesn't the Supreme Court of Israel stand very much in a position to block it?
Story.
Supreme Court would stand to block it. It's more than that. It's not that we take people from one place to the other and they're happy about it. Sometimes those who make Aliyah are happy, but to take an Arab population who is really with roots in the land and to tell them, now we want this a Jewish state, so you better go to another state, this is impossible.
No, he means
changing the map, but just changing.
This is changing the map. This exchange is changing the map. Now, if you ask if it might happen, I don't know. I'm not optimistic about this possibility. You know that now the situation is that the settlers, Jewish settlers, do not want to move and to pull the settlements from the area, territories. If politically this will be the decision, it will not be a simple move. It will be very complicated, very. Without, it doesn't matter what are our political views, if we have those or others. This is something people, they really believe in their right to be there. And all the same, the I think the Arab population, and even more. This is their country, and this is what they believe. So I don't know. I'm not a politician. I don't know if we can draw a new map. Maybe it looks simple, but it looks to me very, very complicated. I don't know if the court. This will be the question: where comes the, you know, where to draw the line between a political issue and an issue of rights, where the court comes in and decides.
Moshe, you want to say something?
Yeah, I want to say one thing. I think a nation state, and there are many nation states in the world that are, you know, Catalonia might be a nation state soon, and it will have an ethno-cultural majority there. And a nation state is the test of a nation state, how it treats its minorities.
Absolutely.
That's the test. And we expect, and there is a lot of it, we accept our minorities, our citizens, to be full-fledged citizens, protected with all the economic, political rights, and cultural rights that everybody gets. Now, when Lieberman tells you that you can redraw the map, so change their citizenship, not change their location, right? That's the idea. Basically, he says their citizenship is not an anchored right. It's a gift given to them by this majority, mm-hmm. and can be withdrawn or not according to the majority. If you think through this idea, basically, you put this minority in such a vulnerable place in the country, because the message you send them is, your citizenship here is really tenuous. It might be taken, might be given, etc. No, that's not the way a country treats its citizens. Citizenship is entrenched right of a member of the country to his country. Now, and that's what's wrong with Lieberman's suggestion. And by the way, because it's not going to be implied anyhow, what you are left with is a message, and is a very difficult message from a state to its own minority. It's very easy, by the way. Look, the fabric of relationship is very gentle. It's very easy to escalate those tensions. We know how you do them. And usually what happens to them is that they fulfill themselves. So I think within more or less the green line borders, with different, you know, changes, corrections, etc., with security arrangements, Israel can be a vibrant nation state that will respect its minorities and give it all the things that minorities in a country deserves. And by the way, I think this will be an opinion of many, many Israelis.
But my question is, what are you going to do when Jews are a minority?
Jews are not going to be a minority within the kind of the pre-67 borders. They're not. Then I'll tell you one thing.
If Jews will become a minority
in their own country, they don't deserve a country.
Well, but they will be if nothing is done.
Well, if they will annex the West Bank, right, etc., that will be the case. Now, you ask me about...
I'm asking them without
annexing. No, I mean, there is no reason why. There is population growth. I mean, Stanley had the numbers. There will be... We will always have around 20%... Arab Israeli citizens, and they're welcome. They are part of our country. They are our citizens, and their citizenship is not a gift that we give them and we might take them if it suits us. I mean, that's a very...
So it's such a... It would represent such a defeat for both nationalism, mm-hmm. and democracy to give up on multi-ethnicity, on heterogeneity, on otherness. I mean, that would be the absolute defeat of both those ideals. I mean, it would be just an expression of sheer despair. It would not be anything else. And there's no reason to give up on that. I mean,
we didn't really overcome uprooting people from the state, Arabs. This is still the
right.
most complicated
right.
issue that is, you know, around
right.
our head and hangs around above our head. So the idea that it will be done is really not in a democratic state.
I want to thank our extraordinary panelists, and thank you for coming.